Good morning, everybody. This is Randy with Randy's RV Bible Study. It's May 25th. It's Saturday, May 25th. Yes, that's what day it is. And we're going to talk about perilous times. And we're going to talk about, I'm not really an end time guru, so to speak. I will say this. Not only are preachers talking about the end days, the end of days, the last of days, the last of the last of days, but the whole entire world is speaking of it. Jesus said that you will know the times and the seasons because even the apostles themselves, the disciples, were asking, when is your kingdom coming? When are the last days? We all have that question. Burning desire to know when that time is. Well, Jesus talks about knowing the seasons. You see summer approaching right now. You see, for some of you it's spring. Here in Florida it's a constant summer, but especially in Southwest Florida. But springtime is an example. You see spring coming and summer approaching, but you see the buds budding, just like you see fall and you see the seasons. You can feel it, you could smell it in the air. You ever smell fall in the air? Well, just like that, we know where we're at in these, probably the last of the last days. Although when we talk about the last days, Timothy's talking, 2 Timothy, we're going to read 2 Timothy 3, by the way, so if you want to get your Bible, follow along. Many people are asking what I'm using the New King James Version. I like that version. But these last days are really the time between Christ's first appearing and Christ's second coming. That is indicator of the last days. Because Christ is coming back and to set up his kingdom. We know there are some severe things happening in Israel that's pointing to what could be Ezekiel 38. We Christians should be very excited as we see the rapture approaching. We don't know the time. We don't know the hour, but we can see that that is really likely very soon, which has propelled me to do these series. So today we're going to talk about perilous times, and perilous means full of danger. You can figure out what that word means, but it sounds awful. Perilous, doesn't it? I got to drink more coffee. Full of danger and risk. The world is it's a very dangerous place. For the Christian, which we're not really going to get into, you will be persecuted. We're getting into days where the truth and the lie is being flip-flopped around. What's good is bad. What's bad is good. Nothing makes sense. Genderism doesn't make sense. It just doesn't make good sense. It doesn't. It's so odd that we're in these times. And if you speak out against them, or if you have your own opinion, in America, where we've been brought up in this country where we can say and have healthy conversations and debates and arguments, that we're coming to a day where what you say may be considered against the law. So, very soon we shall see. It's not getting any better, nor is it going to get better. We've crossed thresholds. We're not going backwards. We're not going back to a more moral standard. We've crossed that line. So that's my introduction. So perilous times. 1 John 2:18. Little children, it is the last time. We have heard the Antichrist shall come. Even now there are many Antichrists, whereby we know it is the last time. So John, talking in his day, looking at the Antichrist, many Antichrists. Well, Hitler was an Antichrist, but there are many Antichrists. Hitler's an extreme Antichrist version, but there are many. The carnal mind is an earthly, natural mind governed by mere human nature. To be carnally minded is enmity between you and God, against God. Enmity, that means you're hostile to God. If you're living in a natural human nature state, meaning you just live, breathe, eat when you want, get drunk, go have sex, do whatever you want to do, feels good at the time, what you think you need, blah, blah, blah. That's all I can think of, blah, blah, blah. You are against God because you're not subject to the law of God, and nor can you be. So that's what a carnal-minded person looks like. He cannot be subject to God's law. Are we talking about the Ten Commandments? Yes, but we're also talking about the Bible, God's ways. This is the Bible. This is your manual. You want to know how to live? This is it. You want to see yourself? You're going to see yourself here. And there's many scriptures to go through. So let's get into scripture, because I could talk all day about this, and so could you probably. But know that scripture is interpreting scripture. That's, you want an answer for something? Go find it in scripture, and you will find other scriptures that support that scripture. There's over 100,000 references of scripture supporting other scripture. That's how we interpret the Bible, period. It's not by our own rational thinking alone. I mean, you have to have rational thinking, obviously, but it comes from the Word of God. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. We talked about perilous, dangerous times. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers. I'm going to take a break there. Blasphemers. Well, they're not going to accept the Holy Spirit. That's one. Blasphemy, that cannot be. That's one sin that cannot and will not be forgiven. If you do not accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you will not. You don't have a salvation, and you won't experience eternal life in heaven. You will experience eternity in hell now, and then hell, death, and Hades itself will be thrown into the lake of fire, and you'll experience eternity where you don't ever die, in a place called the lake of fire. So they'll be lovers of themselves. Folks, all you have to do is open up your Facebook today and you will see lovers of yourself being displayed. Proud blasphemers. Blaspheming. You could blaspheme the Lord Jesus Christ many ways. You could blaspheme his name. You could bring his name down to an excrement. Many of you are doing that. Many Christians are doing it. To use OMG, stop using that phrase. You are blaspheming God's name. You are bringing it to a low place. Stop using GD. Stop using Stop saying Jesus Christ like his name doesn't mean anything. Use another name. Use your mother's name. In place your name. Put Muhammad's name in there. Allah, the Buddha's name. I don't care. If you're a Christian, you need to stop using the Lord's name in vain. Stop it. Arrest your mouth. Figure out a way to stop doing that. He will hold nobody guiltless who blasphemes his name. Period. That's what Scripture says. That's not coming from me. It's coming from Scripture. Stop saying OMG like it's just okay. It isn't. And if you're a Christian, and if you're saying and professing yourself to be a Christian and not living the Christian life, not doing what the Bible says, not your life does not line up with Scripture, stop calling yourself a Christian, because now you're blaspheming his name too. You're saying, I am a follower of Jesus, but I don't go to church, and I don't live out the Bible, and I make up my own rules, and I'm living with my boyfriend or girlfriend, I smoke pot, I get drunk, I mean, stop it. That's blasphemy. That's blasphemy. I could have stopped right there. Disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Verse 3, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. I don't know if that's just that's where we're at today. Lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. That's my country, United States of America. Having a form of godliness, but denying its power. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power of change. What's the power? The new creation, the born again believer. That's the power of the Bible. That's it. The born again, the change. People should know a change in you. But you have a form of godliness. You say you're a godly person, but you're a hypocrite because you don't live it. You don't live it. And the Bible says, if such people turn away, that's what it says. And from such people, turn away. Explanation point. For of this sort are those who creep in the household who make captives, gullible women, and loaded down with sins. That sounds disgusting. Led away by various lusts, always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. They're always learning. They're always going to churches, other cults. They're always jumping into some kind of spiritual, but never coming to the knowledge of truth. The knowledge of truth, what is the knowledge of truth? The gospel, the salvation, the saving grace. Jesus Christ is the truth. He said, Pilate asked Jesus, what is truth? While he was staring into the face of truth. What a quinky dink. He is the truth, the way, and the life. Now as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so did these people resist the truth. Men of corrupt mind, disapprove concerning the faith, but they will progress no further, for their folly will be manifest to all, as theirs also was. You're not going to hide from God. So I'm just going to go through some scripture here. Last day, false teachers and followers are concerned with external appearances. Their outward form of Christianity and virtues makes these individuals even more dangerous. Like I said, Paul is talking, about the knowledge of the truth. He's equating it with being a saved, being salvation, being saved. He's equating and identifying men and women who were jumping from one false teacher or cult to another. That, you know, it's not about the preacher, guys. I could sit here and name about 50, 60 false teachers today that are prominent in the arena of false teaching, according to the Bible, what the Bible says a false teacher is. And these are ever coming, they never come to an understanding of Jesus Christ. Matthew 23:25, our Lord talks, he's dealing with the Pharisees. He's talking, you cleanse the outside of your cup, but you don't clean the inside of your cup. It'd be like, you know, this cup's all clean. Here you go, and you're drinking out of it, but it's filthy inside. Who wants to drink? I just want to drink some more coffee. Who wants to drink a cup that's dirty inside? Please clean the inside, your inside. The last days, there are scoffers that will come scoffing, following their own sinful desires. To scoff is to mock or to belittle. You know, be like saying, you know, somebody saying to you, you know, I'm a scientist. And they go, you're a scientist? Yeah, right. That's scoffing. So let's get into a few examples here that this thing is packed. I probably could do 2 episodes. I want to do it in 1. I'm trying to get it down. So lovers of money, that's obvious. Lovers of money. What's the Bible say about being a lover of money? You can't love money and God. people will say one of the most misquoted verses is money is the root of all evil. No, the love of money is the root of all evil. The love. Follow corruption. You know, what do they say? Follow the money, you'll follow where the corruption is. The love of money. Well, you say, I don't love money. Well, if somebody handed you $1 million and said, hey, will you betray this guy for $1 million? That's a temptation. Just one dude I got to betray? That's it? I just got to say one lie for $1 million? I got to... It's happening, and it's happened throughout time. Jesus was sold for 40 pieces of silver from Judas, who decided that the gig was up. I need to make what I can, because he was in charge of the money and he was pilfering from the money, and he knew the gig was up. Decided 40 pieces or 30 pieces of silver was worth the exchange to betray his Lord and his friend. Because the gig's up. It ain't going the way I want it. Boasters, these are self-confident. And this is an unhealthy self-confidence. It's one thing to have self-confidence, but we have put it onto this. There's an unhealthy self-confidence. Give you some example. King Nebuchadnezzar, he made an image of gold and then loudly proclaimed that all the nations of people in the language, that they must fall down and worship the image of gold. I think it's interesting. It's an image of gold. And we just talked about lovers of money. Whoever does not, he says, whoever does not bow down and worship will be immediately thrown into a burning, blazing furnace. Satan is interesting, because if you see here the parallel between, he's always got a counterfeit from God. He's always running a counterfeit to God. What do I mean? Well, the blazing furnace reminds me of the burning of the lake of fire. So if you don't worship me, this gold statue, this thing made of gold that looks like me, my image, then you're going to be thrown into my burning furnace. It's just an interesting parallel, I think. There's insecurity that derives from self-confidence. Well, that sounds weird, doesn't it? Well, there is. Proverbs 28, 20, and how do I do that? Here's what I'm saying to you. How do you find out these answers? Scripture interprets Scripture. I suggest you go through there and get a Thompson's Guide. Get one of these. That's just my opinion. Get a reference guide. Go through these Scriptures for yourself. It's intense. And you will grow spiritually by reading Scripture. Scripture interprets Scripture. This is a living word. This Bible is alive. It's active. It's not just a book. It's not just a book you're reading full of weird stories. It is a book. It is the way to salvation. It is the way that you and I shall live. It is the manual. The human being. You need to read this every day. I need to read this. Insecurity is deriving from self-confidence. Proverbs 28:26. He who trusts in his own heart is a fool, but whoever walks wisely be delivered. What are you saying? Follow your heart is the message of the day. Follow your heart. Your heart. My heart is good. It's not what the Bible says. See, if you read the Bible, then you know that. You know that the heart is deceptively wicked. Who can know it? Only the Lord can know it. Your heart, my heart, we can't trust. I know that's contradictory, but what's being taught today. But you can't trust your heart. You can't. Your heart needs to be full of Christ. You need to trust in the Word of God. God, should I go this way? Should I do this thing? God, you're the Lord of my life. And should I get into this relationship? Should I do this thing? Should I be in a relationship at all? Should I walk this way? You need to not follow your heart, guys. It's wicked. It's so contrary to what the world is teaching. And what people are teaching their children. If I was to follow my heart, and I have done that, and it's led me down some dark paths. 1 Corinthians 10:12 says, therefore let him think he stands take heed lest he falls. We're talking about being self-confident here. There's an insecurity due to self-confidence, and it sounds contradictive, but it's not. It's insecurity. Your security lies in Christ, God's word. That's where your security lies in, you know. Then we have people, you know, with that you have the boasting. People's plans, you know, prosperity, Jesus, the parable, the rich fool, be careful. Listen, Luke 12, 16, you know, you have the parable, the rich fool. Well, let's go there. Luke 12, 16. This is Jesus talking. Then he spoke a parable to them, saying, the ground of a certain rich man yielded plentifully. And he thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no room to store my crops? And he thought within himself, so he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns, and I will build greater, and there will be store all my crops and all my goods. And I will say to my soul, as well, say to my soul, soul, in my heart here, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take it easy, man. Eat, drink, and be merry. We have a lot of that here in Sarasota County, you know, retirees. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Then whose will those things be which you have provided? So he says, who lays up his treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. So the Lord tells us there that he's a fool. We should set our affections on things above, not here on earth. He was boasting. I got all this stuff, man. I got it. I'm going to store it all, and then I just hang out and drink margaritas by the sunset and hang out and just watch time tick by. I don't know. Oh, Jesus says, well, you're a fool because now today's your life is over. That's how dumb it is to rely. It's okay to have a 401k. It's okay to think about your future. But let's put it in context. Be thankful for the Lord for what he has provided. He's provided for you. It's not even yours. Okay, the selfish. We have examples of the selfish. You can figure it out for yourself. We have Cain. Cain said, am I my brother's keeper? Really, I just killed my brother. But God's asking, where's your brother? He knows. God asks you questions, by the way. If you listen to him, a lot of times he'll just ask you questions so you can answer for yourself. Am I my brother's keeper? In a disdainful way, I could just hear it. You know, Abel was the keeper of sheep. Cain is twisted around. He's so selfish there. Haman with Mordecai. And this is Old Testament. There's so many cool stories. If you haven't read that story, read it. It's such an interesting story about Esther. Haman thought in his heart, whom would the king delight to honor more than me? He's thinking the king's going to honor him. The king's talking about Mordecai, and Haman the whole time is thinking it's about him. The selfish. The priest and the Levite in the parable when they passed by the wounded man, the Samaritan actually helps the wounded man. I don't even know if we know who the wounded man is in the story, but the priest and the Levite, these are the religious Christian, these are the godly people, the priest and the Levite, they just pass by the wounded person. And who takes care of him is the Samaritan. The Samaritan takes care of the wounded man. So the selfish, they don't want to deal with that. I don't. Just walk on by like it didn't happen. Just walk on by. I don't know, you got to turn that switch off. I'm not worried about it. Too much to deal with, man. Then I have to get involved. Then I got to get this guy some help. I got my time. I don't know who this guy is. You know, the Samaritan, he jumps in and he helps the guy. So there's the selfish. These are last days. What we see in the last days evil times are marked by social and political corruption. Many of you think we have political corruption, which we do. It's pervasive. But we have a lot of social corruption. We have a ton of it. Names that are all these social things, all these, you know, goody, so-called goody-goody two-shoe social, we need to save the planet. Black Lives Matter, I'm sorry, all lives matter. That whole movement is false. The whole movement was false. It's designed to separate human beings. There's not races of people. There's one race of people, and I'm going to tell you right now, it's the human race. There are different ethnicities. There are people with different color. But if you cut me and you cut them, the same color is going to come out of them. The same color that our Lord and Savior bled is red. It's red. It's the same color. The color of your skin has nothing to do with who you are. Stop it. Stop the madness. You know, political corruption, social corruption, the social movements of the day are corrupt. They're taking money. They're designed to cause division among people. They're corrupt. They're corrupt. Many of these organizations that you think you're sending your money to, they're making money. They're paying themselves under the guise of this good cause. That's frightening. So corrupt, for all flesh corrupted their way on the earth. If we go to Genesis, and God looked on the whole earth, and all flesh corrupted their way on the earth. This is back in Genesis, before he decided to destroy the earth. That's where he's at, as he looks on the earth and see the corruption. Covetousness, eager or excessive desire, especially with wealth or possession. But you can have an excessive desire for somebody's wife. You could have a desire for somebody's, because you don't have it. And we just have that today. Social media is encouraging us to compare ourselves with others, and it's fostering this insecurity and covetousness. I need to look like that. I need to be like that. I need to be doing, hi, they're taking pictures, but you don't know what's in their heart. They're taking pictures and you're feeling sick because you're not doing what they're doing, and they're not doing anything. They're taking pictures with a smile. Maybe we should go back to taking pictures like they used to do back in the Civil War days. That was a true statement, maybe, of what was going on inside. I don't know. That's hilarious to me, those pictures. A desire for another's possessions. Man, look at that car, you know? But we're all guilty of this. We got to be careful. Yes, and resulting in what else? Oppression. That this is the results of evil times. Oppression, covetousness. I'm sorry. This is what results in the sin of covetousness. Oppression, theft, disobedience, robbery, meanness, scoffing, and selfishness. David took somebody else's wife because he was coveting her, checking her out as she was bathing. Why is her name Bathsheba? I don't know, that's just a question I have. Dishonoring of parents, natural, that's just unnatural affection. By stubbornness and sensuality, by lack of respect, by disrespecting their mother, by cursing their father, by strife in the household, by failure in providing for, by disobedience. I remember the 70s, late 60s and 70s when I grew up, this started to take place in the home. The dishonoring of parents. The 60s was a big proponent of that. We're far from the 60s, but now we have generations that have fallen into that. They don't even know. Generations before that, you didn't talk back to your parents. You just didn't talk back. You didn't talk back to elders. You didn't talk back to parents. If you did, the consequences were severe. You get your mouth slapped or something. But you sure didn't talk back to parents, and this is how children yet are now raised, to just be disobedient, curse their fathers and their mothers. And part of that is due to the fact that we have broken homes and the marriages, and Satan's having a field day with marriages and broken homes and blended families, and I mean, it's a mess, y'all. Ingratitude, thanklessness, and selfishness again appears. Slander, despisers, treachery. This is anyone who treachery, a despiser. Let's look at that in the scripture. Hebrews 10:28. Again, I'm looking for scripture to get a meaning. What's a despiser? Hebrews 10:28. Anyone who sets aside the law of Moses dies without the mercy of the evidence of two or three witnesses. Did you hear that? Anyone who set aside the law of Moses would die without the mercy. That's merciful, that two or three witnesses. There's no mercy there. You're setting aside the law of Moses and you're living on your way. You die without any mercy. And folks, if you continue to live like that in your life, if you continue to live like that, you're going to die in it. You're going to die here. And then you have to face the Lord and you will not spend your eternity with God. But I'm a good person. No, you're not. You're not gonna get by with your good deeds. We all need salvation. You need Jesus Christ, saving grace and his mercy. You need to fall on his mercy and you need to ask for forgiveness and you need to repent and you need to turn from your sin and you need to live for him and make him Lord of your life. That's what's required. Pride, conceit, self-love, haughtiness, arrogance, self-righteousness, spiritual pride, self-exalting. I mean, the list is exhaustive. We are warned about pride. When pride comes, then shame comes. Then comes shame. We have Pride Day. Come on. Pride goes before a fall. You are parading your sin. That's what that is. We're pridefully parading our sin. I don't know what's next. Hezekiah, here's some examples of warn. Hezekiah, Haman again, was very prideful. Nebuchadnezzar was self-righteous and prideful. God brought him low, low, low. Belshazzar decided to drink out of the church, the temple's sacred items, started to have a party and get down on it. And yeah, that you can read about the writing on the wall with Belshazzar. All Old Testament stuff, very cool. Hezekiah, very, very great stories. And they're not just stories. They're Bible stories. They're Bible truths. They're stories of people's lives. They're stories of people's lives. True stories, that's what I should say. They're not stories. They're true stories. Pleasure seekers, worldliness, indulgence. I knew this would take a long time. That results in poverty. These are the results of pleasure seekers and worldliness. Poverty from the example of Proverbs 21:17. He who loves pleasure will be a poor man. Think about it. False security. It's a false security, your pleasure seeking. You're spiritually barren. Jesus talks about the ones that fell away, the ones that the word that fell away in the thorns. Those are the ones choked away with cares and riches and the pleasures of this life, bringing no fruit to maturity. I added my own thought. The charismatic church, all they talk about is riches, the prosperity gospel. Well, the Bible talks about prosperity, sure does, but most of the time it looks like it's in a negative connotation. If you are prosperous, if you are rich, praise the Lord. If God's done that for you, you need to be so thankful, and you need to give your money. Basically, you need to be doing something good with that money, because I don't see any. I just see that it gets you away from the Lord. Jesus said himself, it's more difficult for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Why is that? Because he doesn't need Christ. He's got it all. He is supplied with worldly riches. Just like the rich young ruler came to Christ and asked him, hey, what must I do to enter heaven? And Jesus, good teacher. And Jesus says, why do you call me good? There's nobody good. So he would go back to, because Jesus is the Lord. He's God. He's sinless. You and I are not sinless. He's telling this guy, you're a good teacher. What? Jesus says, why do you call me good? You know what you must do. You must follow the Ten Commandments. Oh, I've done all that. You followed all the Ten Commandments? Okay. First of all, Jesus didn't even say you're a liar, but I'm going to go ahead and say the dude's a liar. Nobody's followed the Ten Commandments. No, but why are they there? Well, because we need a Savior. And to follow the Ten Commandments, we need to be born again. We need help. Because all we have is our natural human nature that wants these things, pleasure. We want like little kids. We're like little kids. We're pleasure seekers. We want to just, that's all we want. We want ease and pleasure, and we want it to go our way. We want sex, drugs, rock and roll, man. That's the way I live. Pleasure seeking. You have this presumption. You're back to Luke. I got all my stuff in the barns. I got my 401k. I'm good. I'm good over here. I've got everything that I need. I'm set up for the future. You could die today. Jesus said to this guy, you're a fool because you're going to die today. See, God knows your time. God knows your time. That's seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. Set your affections on things above in heaven, not on things of the earth where moth and rust could destroy. The earthly pleasures, they mean nothing. Gold means nothing to the Lord. It's made, he made it into roads. God's going to destroy this earth, this world, the sun, the time, all of it. Why? Because we worship. All of us, we worship the earth. We worship the world. That's right. We worship. Now it's the climatologist saying that we're such dire. The Pope has said that we are in such dire straits for climate. You know what? God is holding this earth together, not anything else. And by the way, the earth is wearing out like a garment. Ain't nothing you can do about it. Should we be managers of the earth, good stewards? Okay. But the Bible says clearly what's going to happen to the earth. It's going to be destroyed. God himself is going to destroy it. Worry about it all you want. Presumption. Back to Luke. Back to that story in Luke. I will say to my soul, soul, I have all the goods. I got it down, man. Laid up for many years. Chill out on the beach. Relax. Take it easy. And your soul, you're dead. You're dead that day. Yeah. Have a heart attack as you kick it back. Oh, it's so good. Boom, you're gone. Spiritual death are the pleasure seeking. You'll have spiritual death. 1 Timothy 5:6. But she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. Impurity, evil passions, spiritual ignorance, unbelievers, opposers, carnal minded. Listen, I could go on and on. Sin is going to be exposed. It's known to God. It's inevitable. It's going to be exposed. Luke 12:2, for there is nothing covered that will not be revealed, nor hidden that will be not known. The Lord has infinite knowledge. Listen, I've gone so far over my time in this. Are we in end times? You figured out. This could be your end day right here today. The Christian, we should be walking into heaven like not much of a transition, because we're living that way on earth. This stuff doesn't matter. What matters is your soul and the people's soul around you and your salvation. So I would get right with the Lord. Christian, if you're not right, you can see yourself in there. Repent. Ask for forgiveness. You know, God is merciful. He will forgive you. Non-Christian, he will forgive you. He will save your soul from eternal lake of fire. He will do it. You have to ask him. You have to turn from your sin. Ask for forgiveness. You have to be subject to him. He is the Lord. You are not. I am not the Lord. You are not God. You're acting like you're the God and the Lord of your life. That's not truth. Pilate said, what is truth? Looking and staring at the face of truth. Listen. Repent, turn from your wicked ways. Turn from your pride. Turn from your pleasure seeking, the love of yourself, your self-confidence, your arrogance, your boasting. Turn from it now. We know that we are in the last days. We know that. And for the Christian, the born again, you must be born again and in the kingdom of heaven. For that person, the days coming, we're living exciting days because we know Jesus is returning very soon. We could see his return very, very soon. Well, thank you for listening, and I hope you have a great day. Listen, I love you, and Jesus Christ loves you, has so much mercy and love. He died for you. He loved you so much. He died for you. He loved you to death. God bless you all. Take care.